Here's now the proposition about the direction. If I'm given such a resolution of the identity, then I always can define my operators via integrals. So that's the integration part of the whole theory. Huh? So that's kind of doing integration theory in operator valued setting. So in our measure or our distribution function is given by those e lambdas. So we assume we are given them from somewhere. So e lambdas, lambda in R, or this function lambda goes to e lambda. So this should be, and let me call it in this context, maybe a projection valued measure is the better case, maybe the better name for this direction, because it indicates that we have a measure and we want to use this for doing integration. Huh? So let this be projection valued measure, so our PVM, and we take now a measurable function on R, any measurable function f from R to C. This should be measurable. And then we claim that there exists an operator which is given by integrating the function lambda with respect to this e lambda. Then there exists, and in general setting, this will be an unbounded operator. So we should also think about the domain. And in particular, of course, the domain should be dense. But actually, this is always true. Namely, so then there exists a densely defined operator, which, let's say, I denote by TF. So just to put the F somewhere. Of course, this depends on F. And so, okay, so now I want to do more general, not just integrating the function lambda, but any measurable function. So I mean, for writing my operator T, I'm just integrating the identity function lambda. But of course, if I have given such a measure, then I can integrate any measurable function. So namely, I integrate F lambda DE lambda. Yeah, and we should say how it is defined, or maybe first we should say what is its domain. So this guy has a domain, which of course also depends on F. So the domain of TF is given by those axes in my Hilbert space for which the integral F lambda absolute value squared with respect to dx e lambda x is less than infinity. This again is an ordinary Stieltjes integral, because this is an ordinary distribution function for each x. And so we are checking for each x whether this integral of this function is finite or not. Okay, and here, I mean, this is something which one has to show, that actually the set of x's for which this is less than infinity is dense. Okay, and so this is domain. And then my operator itself is uniquely determined to what we had before by looking on inner products. So I'm looking on the inner product XTFX. So I'm doing this for all x in the domain of this operator. So for all x's which satisfy this property by just doing what we did before, namely by declaring that this should be the integral of f lambda dx e lambda x. This should be true for all x in the domain of TF. And the domain of TF are the axes for which this integral here is an L2, which means this integral here also makes sense. It's now a complex, or in this case, it's actually a no, I mean the f can be here even complex valued. So I mean it's not necessarily a real number. It can also be a complex number. But here, if I assume that my function is an L2, then this integral here, as an ordinary Stieltjes integral, makes sense. Good, so this is uniquely determined, and maybe let me also give you the norm of vectors. So maybe it's good to see the following. Furthermore, we have for all x in the domain of my operator that the norm of tf of x, so if I apply tf to x, then this is actually this integral here which I had before. So this is actually f of lambda squared dx, e lambda x. So in particular, this of course is also a finite quantity, as it should be. And so the domain, it's again, I mean, somehow the domain of my operator are exactly the elements for which, after applying the TF, I'm still in my Hilbert space, which means, maybe I should have the square here, which means that of course the norm should be finite. And the norm is exactly this quantity, so I mean it's of course very canonical to define the domain of my operator by the axis for which this quantity is finite. So everything fits together nicely. It is as you would expect it to be. So I mean those statements are probably not surprising. Of course you have to prove them all, and I mean there are technical things to do and to check, but it's not too. I think it's in principle everything can be could we should be able to do more or less all those things if we are using the properties from the classical Stieltjes integrals and classical measure theory. Yeah, but I mean we are not going to do this now. I just want to give you the details and maybe the statements. And maybe now the most important statement, of course, is the spectral theorem, where I'm not starting. So here I'm starting with a projection valued measure, and then I can define operators by doing integrations. But now the spectral theorem is the other way around. Of course, we are given an operator, and then we would like to see that there is a projection valued measure such that I can write the operator as such an integral. And that's the spectral theorem, which tells us that this is exactly the case. So the spectral theorem, or maybe let me denote the spectral theorem in two ways. So first of all, maybe do again this direction here, and then look on the function where f of lambda is equal to lambda. Because this is how we want to write self-adjoint operators, and maybe it would be good first to check whether we have a general statement that ensures us that we always get a self-adjoint operator there. So again, this is maybe the easy direction, the direction which corresponds to this, by specializing it to the function f of lambda is equal to lambda. So again, let e lambda be our projection valued measure, and then we look on the special operator. Then this operator t, which is the integral over lambda dE lambda, which according to this general proposition we know exists. So this is a self-adjoint operator, not just symmetric, but self-adjoint. So this is really a self-adjoint operator, and the domain of course is a special case of what we had there above. So this domain d of t is equal to those x's in my Hilbert space for which the integral, and now I should take f of lambda absolute value squared, but f of lambda is just a lambda, and we are integrating here over the real axis. Okay, so I don't need the absolute value, so it's just lambda squared d x comma e lambda x, for which this is less than infinity. So this is just the specialization of the general case to the function f of lambda is equal to lambda, but of course in addition we are here claiming that the integral, this operator which we get as this integral here, is a self-adjoint operator. So this tells us that this is a way to get self-adjoint operators, and now of course the point is that this is the only way. That's the reverse direction, maybe that's the most interesting direction, and that's maybe what we really should call the spectral theorem. So namely, if I start now with a self-adjoint operator, then I find such a PVM. So let us do this. So let T be, and let me say explicitly, an unbounded self-adjoint operator, because this is also true for unbounded operators, huh? Not just for bounded. Of course, we have the same statements and theorems for bounded operators, but then, of course, we don't have to bother about domains and those things. Huh? But in this setting here is really somehow the most general for unbounded operators. Huh? Okay, so we start with an unbounded self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space, typically infinite dimensional, and then we are claiming then there exists resolution of identity, and of course it's uniquely determined. Huh? There is no freedom which we have there, so then there exists a uniquely determined, and maybe in this direction it's more appropriate or more common to call it a resolution of the identity, because here we want to resolve our Hilbert space according to the given operator T. Okay, so in this setting it's usually called a resolution of identity, these E lambdas, but of course it's the same as a projection valued measure. So then there exists a uniquely determined resolution of identity, E lambda in R, such that my operator T is really of the form integral of lambda dE lambda. And in the part before, we convinced us that whenever we have such a resolution of the identity, such a guy is a self-adjoint operator. So this fits together. But the point is, we really get all self-adjoint operators in this form. Yeah, so that's the spectral theorem. And of course, for proving this, one has to do quite a bit. I'm not going into the proof. I just want to give you the statement, and you should get an idea of what this all means. So I mean, the technical details of proving this are quite involved. So there is a lot to do. And we could do this if we would, if we would have more, couple of more hours for addressing this, but I think it's not really so relevant for us. It's more that you should see the statement and understand what it means. And let me maybe just rewrite our finite dimensional example and the one of the multiplication operator again in this language, or maybe also in the language of the e-lambdas again, just to make sure that we really are clear what we are talking about. Of course, I mean, this setting is very general, but of course it also includes the finite dimensional situation. So maybe we should see what we have there. So let us take the dimension of the Hilbert space, less than infinity, the spectrum of our operator, which in finite dimensions usually I call my operators or matrices A. In general, I'm calling them T. So here I have my matrix or my operator in a finite dimensional Hilbert space, and its spectrum is given by lambda 1 up to lambda k, which I have ordered. Those are the real eigenvalues, and I put them in order. And with P lambda, we denoted the orthogonal projection onto the eigenspace to lambda, for lambda in the spectrum. So P lambda was the orthogonal projection onto the eigenspace, which we called H lambda. So this is the eigenspace the space of eigenvectors for the eigenvalue lambda. So x in H, such that Ax is equal to lambda x. And we do this. We can do it for all lambda, but the only interesting ones are the ones in the spectrum. And then, what is now our E lambda? The E lambda is essentially the projection corresponding to the interval from minus infinity to lambda. So in this language, we are just summing over all p lambdas up to the point. We are summing over all p lambda i's up to the point lambda. So then the e lambda is here given by the sum over all lambda i's, which are less than lambda, for the p lambda i's. And of course, our operator A, which is given as the integral over lambda dE lambda, in this case, just comes down to a sum where I'm summing over the increments at the lambda i's, and the increments are given by the projections onto the corresponding eigenspaces. So this here is then really the sum over 1 to k lambda I p lambda I. So maybe let me draw a picture. So maybe like in the Stieltjes integral for real valued or complex valued or for measures on R, we also had the situation that we decomposed a general distribution function into an pure part, an atomic part, an absolutely continuous part, and the rest, a singular part. But what we have here, of course, is just the atomic part, which are just the jumps. So we only have here jumps. So our E lambda, the E lambda here is a function. Of course, it's not a real valued or complex valued function now, but it's a function which takes on values which are operators or projections. But again, it's very simple. Namely, it's a function which is a piecewise constant. So namely, up to the point lambda 1, the smallest eigenvalue, it's just 0, the 0 operator. Then at this point here, it jumps to the projection p lambda 1, the projection onto the eigenspace of the eigenvectors for the eigenvalue lambda 1. And up to the point lambda 2, it has this value. And at the point lambda 2, it jumps again, because then we are making a jump. So this here was lambda 1. So then we are making a jump corresponding to the projection onto the eigenspace for lambda 2. And so what I have here now is the sum of p of lambda 1 plus p of lambda 2 up to lambda 3 and so on. And then I'm jumping again and so on up to lambda k. And in lambda k, I'm jumping to the sum of all p lambda 1 plus p lambda k. But this is just the identity operator. So those guys here are orthogonal. So this here is the projection onto the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda 1. This here is the projection onto the direct sum of the eigenspaces. So this is projecting down onto the eigenvalue lambda 1 and lambda 2. So if I'm having a function x, then I'm taking the sum of the two components corresponding to lambda 1 and lambda 2, and so on. And I'm taking more and more. And so I'm doing jumps here. So it's like the scalar value distribution functions, where I'm doing jumps, and the integral for jumps is just a finite sum. And that's here the same. So this integral, if my function here just has jumps, then this is just given by summing, by a sum, and the increment here corresponds then just exactly to the jump I'm doing here. And the jump I'm doing here is exactly the jump corresponding to the projection onto the eigenspace. So here the jump is p of lambda 1, here the jump is p of lambda 2, here the jump is p of lambda 3, and so on. So this really gives back the classical theorem in this form, which really then corresponds to diagonalizing my operator. And maybe also do the multiplication operator, the real infinite dimensional one, just to see it again there, because this corresponds now to a situation where I don't have jumps. I just have a continuous version. Continuous distribution function. but corresponding to the almost to the absolutely continuous part, not to the exotic other part. And so here again, so our operator Q, so this was the multiplication operator. So at the argument t, it's given by t times f of t, and we are doing this on the Hilbert space L2 of R. And then the resolution of the identity is now just given by projecting my function to this interval from minus infinity to lambda. So this is what we saw before in the motivating example for what the E lambda is. Now just let me write it down again. So then the resolution of identity corresponding to this, so this collection of E lambdas for lambda in R, is given by, yeah, I mean this projection just projects the function from L2 of R onto its path from minus infinity to lambda. So this means E lambda of F, F is a function on in L2 of R, so I'm projecting it down. The function at the point t is before lambda, nothing happens, it's just a function f of t, and afterwards it's put to zero for t greater than lambda. So here is the picture. I mean, I have here, let's say I have here my function f, an L2 function, or maybe here it should go to zero again, or whatever, if I go to. But anyhow, and then if I'm looking on lambda, so what am I doing? I'm taking my function up to the point lambda. It's the same function as before, but here I'm just setting it equal to zero. So this here is now my function E lambda of f. And of course, if I'm moving lambda, if I'm making it bigger and bigger, I'm getting bigger and bigger chunks of my function, and I'm just cutting it at later and later places. And of course, in this case here, this E lambda is increasing in a continuous way. So it's not making jumps. So what it's doing, I mean, in small intervals, it's increasing in a continuous way. And we can also write here the Q in this general setting as the integral over lambda dE lambda with respect to this resolution of the identity. And you can think, I mean, in terms of, I mean, the E lambda is this guy here. So the dE lambda, the increment, this is really what happens on a very small interval. So the dE lambda essentially is a projection onto a function which is localized on a small increment. That was the deltas which I had in the beginning. You can make them smaller and smaller. But of course, there is no dE lambda exactly at this position. But so it's really just a limit of things living on smaller and smaller intervals. So here you're taking essentially the part of the function with this projection, which is localized around lambda. And then this part of the function is essentially getting multiplied with lambda. And then you are summing again all those components together. And then you get also the Q exactly in this form. So the finite dimensional situation corresponds to distribution functions where we only have jumps, and the integral is then a sum. And this multiplication operator, which is more typical in infinite dimensions, this really corresponds to the situation where I have continuous distribution functions. And so this really has to be understood as an integral, which is a limit of sums, but it's not a sum by itself. So it really corresponds to the situation which we had for the Lebesgue-Stieltjes integrals for general distribution functions.